on the side of my head right now. Hey Charlotte, I don't know why I'm typing and talking, but I guess I could go with talking. All right, couple things up here. Pretty excited about this. I always think webinars are slightly interesting when you're just kind of talking out loud to nobody, but then interacting with people. Hopefully the chat will help out with that. So I appreciate you joining, Charlotte. Give it a little bit of time. Roll in. While you're here, Charlotte, I'm going to ask you some questions about if you can read. I'm going to some libraries. How's the size on that? Hi, Isabella. How are you? The size okay for the two of y'all? A little bigger. All right, excellent. So. Big as possible. Size bigger too, please. Okay, I have zoomed in on mine. I hope that is appearing bigger on yours as well. Yay! Hi, Nick Wan. How are you? Nick Wan. I'm sorry. I made the mistake. So many things going. Is the font size better now? Yes, thank you very much, Charlie. I appreciate your eyes on the font to make sure it is large enough. All right, so yeah, I'm pretty excited. We're gonna go through a couple things today. Number one, obviously gonna be doing some live coding here in the RStudio IDE. Also, I'm gonna be showing some resources, both kind of on the web and then a couple resources that I put together for NFL. This needs to be bigger as well. There. How's that look? Fantastic. I'm gonna make this the biggest Tidy Tuesday ever. So yeah, I'll be walking through a couple resources, including Tidy Tuesday, a book that I'm really enjoying right now, Hands-on Machine Learning with R. Cookbook actually put together for nflscrapR data specifically. So some people may have seen this before. But just in case you hadn't, a walkthrough of how to use some nflscrapR data and go through all of that with R. And then lastly, a nice little cookbook example of a parsnip, which is part of the Tidymodels. All right. Yeah, so I mean, this whole thing got started because I actually spoke with Nick about his stream and really enjoyed it. Really wanted to get, you know, another, I guess, resources out there for using R as well as with Python. And kind of as Nick mentioned in his stream, there really is not that much difference between what you're coding with in both. In terms of the syntax, it is very friendly and you're able to kind of express what you want through code as opposed to using something like Excel. But at the end of the day, some of the problems you're trying to solve are going to be very similar. I did want to get started in terms of showing resources again at the beginning. Tidy Tuesday is a project I run that is not necessarily related to sports data, but is a great way to get involved with the community. The basic idea is that every week we upload a new data set here to GitHub. So if you go to github.com/r/datascience/tidytuesday, it gets you to the README, and you can see that there's, you know, almost 50 data sets for this year that we went through. So all of this will have code to read it into R. This last one we did was on adoptable dogs. And the idea is that you can read this data into R, start analyzing it, and then share it on Twitter with the hashtag TidyTuesday. So it kind of gets you started with the community. Maybe you're getting started with using R or doing data science kind of for school or for work or whatever you're doing. This is a good way to get started. The other one for some offline reading would be, I put together an entire guide again for using NFL data through nflscrapR. And doing analysis here. So this goes through basic ideas of coding, some preparation to clean data, and then all sorts of different bar charts and different charting. So with that, I think I'm actually gonna jump into the RStudio IDE. Oh my gosh, this is, let me back out of that. My screen, this is, okay, so that's a little bit better on my screen at least. All right. So I guess the first stage when you're getting started with any project or really getting started with anything, and what I always got found was challenging, was just getting data into your environment. So if you're using something like Excel, you could just go to like file, open file, and you open the file that you want to use. When you think of programmatic access, a lot of the time, it's more about reading in the data with code. So you instantly have to know path structures and how to find the data, as opposed to knowing kind of within a folder structure where it is. So if I went to my home directory, which would actually be like my documents pane inside my home computer, you can see it's got all sorts of different folders. And if I wanted to navigate to specific data, I would actually have to find data such as like, you know, home directory, /application/whatever, actually navigate to it through that way. But because I'm inside RStudio, and specifically because I'm using an R project, I actually go to this specific project, which is nflscrapR. It'll get me started here. So this is the home directory for nflscrapR. So if I use the command git working directory, it actually say I am inside users, Thomas Mock, nflscrapR. So anything I'm reading from, it already knows I'm already inside here. So if I were to say, list files or anything, to list the files in this directory, it's gonna show me the things I can already see here. So code, data, exploration, and plots. Code, exploration, data, plots, as well as the .r project itself, which is what I'm working in. As far as getting data into R now that we kind of have a sense of where things are living, I've got a couple data sets here. Nick was working on this NFL play-by-play data from Kaggle. I also downloaded some additional data sets, the full play-by-play, where I've done some additional data analysis and saved it as an RDS. And then another play-by-play all RDS file just for. Take a step back real quick. Let's load some of that data and then go from there. So if I wanted to read in the data, I know this data is called full play-by-play. So if I said, read CSV, which would allow me to read in a CSV file, I can say full play-by-play .rds. But we notice that this is not a CSV file, it's an RDS. Let's do RDS. If I do this, this is the file I want, it's read RDS, and I try and do that, it's not actually going to be able to find the file, because again, this is actually within the data folder of my directory I'm working with. So a couple different ways of getting there. I can do data/full play-by-play RDS, and you can see it's starting to read it in. This is a pretty large file, so it'll take a few seconds to read in. The main thing is I indicated I want to go into the data folder, indicated a slash to actually indicate where the file is, and then I can go read it in. I was playing around a little bit earlier. with some of this data. Yeah, this will take a while to read in. Again, it's a pretty big file. While that's loading, some of the basics ideas of programming as opposed to using something like a point and click interface is, again, you're typing commands to execute code, which does similar things to actually clicking on them, but instead of having to click on all of them, you're actually typing out the code itself. So I have to read the back end because I just cleared it, let it load. The idea here is that readRDS is a function in R. So you think of a function, like let's say you're in Excel, if you did the average or average, that might be something you're familiar with from Excel, where you actually type out the command average, and then you can wrap a number of cells within that and get the average of those cells. Within R, you do the same thing. You can either have these pre-built functions, so readRDS is from the Tidyverse and is a way to read in RDS files in R. It also has a number of other read systems, such as CSV, general delimited files, flat files of pretty much any type. And I'm assigning this data I'm reading into a data frame, indicating this with the arrow. So it's saying, take this data, assign it to an object, which is this data frame, which is a storage or a table within R. Once I read it in, you can see the data frame here within my global environment. So I can actually do a little bit of exploration. I can see that there are 271 variables with 453,000 observations. So there's quite a bit of data here. If I were to explore this data, there's a couple different ways. So I can first off read the data out and it will show the first few rows. Because this is so wide, it's only going to show the first few columns and it's going to fit it to my screen. So I can see, again, the 455,000 and then 271. I want to do something a little bit more interesting. I can do a glimpse data frame. What this does is gives me a bit more of a summary of the data frame as opposed to showing the first few rows. It's doing it in a wide format, so it's a little bit easier to parse through. So again, it shows me all the different data types. It shows me all the different columns. So we can see total home completion, error percentage, or error EPA, spikes, which is a logical 0 or 1, all sorts of different data sets here. Because there are so many columns, it's a little bit unwieldy to work with this. So what I'm going to do is actually filter it down to a few interesting columns that we could work with. So let's say we were going to do some quick exploratory data analysis. What I could actually do is, let's say we want to do play-by-play is going to be our new data set. So we'll do data frame. I'm going to use the pipe function throughout, which is a way of combining commands. So for to take play by play, I could take the mean of data frame column EPA, something like that. NA. True. So I can take the mean of specific columns with R's built-in functions. So something like mean to take the average of this column. And we can see the EPA is slightly above 0. But that's not that great because I don't actually know, like, is this specific to a team, is specific to a player, specific to a team type? So there's not a lot necessarily going on there. Alternatively, if I wanted to say, figure out what this looks like by team, or by year or by quarter or something like that within NFL data, I could use some commands from the Tidyverse. The Tidyverse, which is a library I loaded, is a meta collection of packages produced by the Tidyverse team. Basically, libraries that allow you to do data visualization, data manipulation, data summarization, basically a library specifically built to work with data and do data analysis. First thing we can do with this data set is, let's say we only want to select a few columns. So we don't want to look at all 271, we just want to look at a few. So we could do select data frame and basically saying from this data frame, we're going to select specific columns. So let's say EPA, which is expected points added, win percentage added, rusher player name, receiver player name, down would be, you know, which down you're saying within the plays, yards to go for a first down, yards gained, air yards, which is how far the ball was actually thrown before the receiver caught it, and then yards after catch, which is the yards after the receiver catches the ball. So if I do this and call it, we can see that now our data set still has the same number of rows, so 450,000 rows, but only 9 columns now. That's how many columns I asked it to select. Another important thing to note here is the first command I gave it was the entry data set, basically the data frame that we have called here. Everything after that it knew to assign as the specific columns of interest. Because I didn't reassign this with an arrow, this actually is an ephemeral object, so it doesn't exist. So if we go back in here to our data in our environment, we can see that there isn't, you know, a special object created from this. I would need to reassign it. So if I assign this to be play-by-play, now when I recall it, it's going to assign it back to the play-by-play object. So now I can look at this, got all of my different 9 columns of interest, all assigned to a specific object. If I wanted to do more things, I could always, you know, play-by-play small. Like I could filter this down or take the first, like take the head, which is the first 5 rows of play-by-play and assign that to a new object. But I don't necessarily want to be reassigning things over and over and over within my analysis when I am working here. Maybe I want to work a little bit interactively. There was a question in the chat in terms of how I'm getting this arrow to actually look like an arrow. So this is Fira code. So when I actually type, you know, the less than symbol and a dot, or sorry, and a dash, it'll show up as an arrow. So once I delete that portion, it actually shows up as an arrow as opposed to the greater than symbol or less than symbol and a dash. So if I didn't want to reassign this and I wanted to work with it interactively, I could assign new functions to things kind of in a piped manner in terms of adding them on to each other with the pipe function. So this function here, which is percentage greater than percentage, actually means the pipe or and then in R and in the Tidyverse. What this does is allows me to say, okay, apply something to whatever's before it. So take the play-by-play data set, and then we can filter team equal to pit. I think I have team. I don't have team in this. Do possession team. Possession team. So if I do this for possession team equal to pit, you can see I go from my, you know, 300,000 rows to 13,000. So I basically said take this data set, filter it where I'm only looking at the team equal to. Maybe I want to say filter and make it where I'm only going to find rows where the receiver player name is equal to Julio Jones. So he's not going to be on Pitt, so we need to change this to Atlanta, and we'll find only only columns, early rows where Julio Jones is the receiver player name. So we call this, we can see that Julio Jones is the only receiver player name we're working with. Really kind of the point I'm emphasizing here is that we're taking something and then applying something and then applying something else. So you can basically work and build up these chain together pipes that will build on what you're creating from before. Again, I haven't reassigned this, so I maybe say this like Julio Jones data frame, and I could sign that back and now it'll show up in my environment. But if I don't want that, I can always remove it. So I can use the RM for remove Julio Jones data frame, and now it is. I don't actually care about the Julio Jones that much. Also within the Tidyverse, there's other things for like grouping data and doing more interesting analysis than just filtering. So if I wanted to take a data set, we'll take the same one play by play. Maybe I want to find what the average EPA or expected points added it's called, and group by specific teams. So I can take the play-by-play data set, group by possession team, and then I want to look at the highest EPA that's been found in the data set. So we can look at top one EPA. What this is doing is taking my data set and applying a grouping variable to it. So everything I call after that group variable will be applied kind of in a grouped fashion. So it'll do it for Atlanta, for Arizona, for Baltimore. Basically every team gets its own analysis after. Then I'm using the top in function, which is taking the first observation, or I could set it to be, you know, 10 observations, but I'll do one. And we're looking at the EPA column. So the highest observation within EPA for every team. And because this is really small, let's actually select EPA and possession team. So you can see, again, I'm building up this pipeline, taking play-by-play data and then grouping by possession team, taking the highest observation, or this is actually the first observation, not the the highest observation, and then selecting only the two columns of interest. And let's filter this dot A, EPA. So because there's NAs in the data set, I want to exclude those and possession team. All right, there we go. So we want to get rid of rows where the possession team was not present. We can see that there was all these expected points added, and the highest one we saw was 9.27 for Tennessee. And there's a number of other rows. I know that my puppy's making lots of noise, so he's gonna hang out for a little bit. We'll probably get him some treats later, but he may just hang out like a dog cat in my lap. That's the dream. So this has been kind of interesting to kind of work through a few Tidyverse functions, but we're not really getting farther in an analysis. But yeah, say hello. This is Howard, so he'll be saying hello here in a little bit. And why Howard is saying hello, I'm going to look over some of my notes that I took, because I was taking notes before I did this. So let's say we wanted to look at a specific team, and we're going to compare a running back and a wide receiver from the same team. So we can actually look and find some data sets where is an A is equal, or we're going to filter so we have only observations where the possession team is real. So we're going to basically remove any observations where the possession team is not true or it's not NA, which means it's missing. We want to exclude those. And then we want to filter to be a specific year. So let's say the 2018 season. So I can say filter game date greater than as date. We'll do 2018 08 01. So August 1st. Filter that game date. Do game date. Call it up here. I need to actually have it in the data set. We'll do that. So now we only have the 2018 season, which started after August of 2018. Again, we have a smaller data set. Instead of 450,000, we have 43,000. And then we're also going to filter so the possession team is going to be equal to Dallas. You'll notice when I'm using some of these logicals that they're actually going to be like this is greater than for equals. I'm not going to use one equal to say Dallas. It's actually going to be two equals. So now it's going to grab only the plays where Dallas is possession team. The reason I'm using Dallas is I live here in Dallas, Texas. I don't actually like the Cowboys, but we'll include them for today's analysis because Ezekiel Elliott just got paid a lot of money to be a running back. So we can see a little bit of Ezekiel Elliott here showing up as a rusher, and then we have someone like, say, Cole Beasley from last year as a receiver. So let's do one more filter, and we'll do rusher player name equal to Ezekiel Elliott or receiver player name equal to Cole Beasley. Let's actually make this more interesting. Rather than saying rusher, let's see what Ezekiel did as a receiver. So now we can see that all of our receivers are only going to be Cole Beasley or Ezekiel Elliott. So we're getting, again, a smaller data set. We're down to 193 observations. So let's take a look at that. And let's say we want to look at their average EPA. So we'll group by receiver player name. And then we'll calculate the average mean number of observations and the standard deviation. I'm using a new function here we haven't seen before, which is going to be summarize. This is basically take a large data set, summarize it to be just a summary observation, so a smaller number of observations. So mean is going to be equal to the mean of EPA. N is going to be equal to the number of observations. We use the N, which is basically like a count of observations, and then SD equal to SD of EPA. Again, because there might be some missing data or NAs within the data set, we're actually going to specify NA remove equal true for both mean and for EPA and for standard deviation. So if we call this, we can see that as a receiver, Cole Beasley had an average EPA of 0.42, 95 catches, or 95 targets, I guess, with a pretty decent standard deviation. Mainly because these plays could be wildly positive, wildly negative, so the standard deviation is actually larger than the average EPA. Unfortunately, we can also see that Ezekiel Elliott has a negative EPA for his catches. So he got paid a lot of money potentially to not add that much EPA as a receiver. Now, there were some big plays where he added good value to the team, but just as a quick observation of filtering to a specific team, filtering to a specific year, filtering to a specific set of players, then doing a group by and a summarize. So being able to take this very quickly and move from a gigantic data set to a more manageable data. So let's actually take just these first few rows, and we will save these as Dallas data frame. We can see it's showing up again in our global environment. So this will be something we can keep working on. And let's do a quick exploratory graph. So to create graphs within the Tidyverse framework, we're going to use ggplot. So again, we're going to take our data set that we just made, Dallas data frame, and we're going to pipe it forward to be into a ggplot. If we do this, we can actually take a look what the plot would be, and because we haven't assigned anything, it's actually just created a blank canvas. The way the ggplot works is, as Nick mentioned, fairly similar to things like matplotlib or to Altair in Python, where you have a grammar of building up graphics over time. There are ways of creating quick plots altogether. But the way that ggplot was originally designed is that it's the grammar of graphics applied to plotting. So there's this method of taking data, applying specific marks or geomes to it, assigning aesthetics to that, and basically building up a graph. So all ggplot knows at this point is that we want to use the Dallas data. We wanted to assign, say, x and y coordinates. We could assign aesthetics, where aesthetics allow us to assign things like X is equal to something, Y is equal to something, and we can do color equal something. Basically, all these are reading the data and assigning different variables to specific things. So if we did X is equal to receiver player name, and Y is equal to EPA, we're basically doing a scatter plot of receivers on the bottom, and the EPA that they have on the Y. Then we want to make sure that the color is going to show up by receiver player name as well. So now we're basically saying we want distinct colors for each receiver. We want to assign X coordinates to those receivers and then see how much variation there is on the Y axis for EPA. And we'll do a GM point to start. I'm going to show you why GM point may not have been the best choice in a second, but we'll do it with a GM point. So if I do this, you can see, again, it's done exactly what I've asked. So it's assigned our receivers on the bottom, so Cole Beasley and Ezekiel Elliott, and then it's at a point for each of the different observations within it. Because I said point, it made sure that each of them were on the factor that they were assigned to, so the receivers' names. But there's a lot of overlap here, so I'm actually missing some observations in the data because they're overlapping, and I can't tell if this is, you know, 5 observations, 100 observations, or 1 observation. So something I could do is independently of assigning aesthetics, which would actually assign like the metadata around the graphic, I can just change how this point looks. So something like alpha equal to 0.2. What this basically is doing is changing the transparency of each dot to be more transparent, basically 20% transparency. So you can see that where there's large bunching of data, it actually gets a little bit darker as opposed to light. Nick is ashamed at the color of this graph because he doesn't like gray backgrounds and or the default colors, but we'll get to that in a second. Additionally, so we've kind of approached this from the transparency perspective, but if we wanted to do this a bit better, we actually use a geom jitter. What this does is actually applies a little bit of randomization so that each of the y coordinates are accurate, but there's randomization of where the dots are placed on the x axis. So now we can see again that most of the data is bunched here below zero for old Ezekiel Elliott, and that Cole Beasley has a greater range of data where a little bit is below zero and a good chunk of it is above zero. So if we wanted to actually change the appearance of this to make it a little bit less exploratory and more, you know, low publication quality, we could do change the theme. So this is what we call theme gray. So if we just did theme gray and called that, it's actually not going to change the graph at all. It's going to leave it as the default theme. But if we did say theme minimal, it's going to drop the gray and make it white. And we've got, you know, gray grid lines now along with the. I could also do theme classic. There's a number of other themes that we could see here. And I seem to have thrown an error. Theme classic. My computer's freaking out because I'm streaming, which is making my laptop stream out an ad. So let's do, there we go. So theme classic drops it down to just lines along the X and Y axis. Additionally, because I don't really like this red and green color scale, and because that doesn't assign to this specific team, and or there could be color blindness in play here with red and green, let's assign that to a different color. So we could say scale color manual. What this allows me to do is basically say color is going to be assigned to a specific value. So values equal to, let's do blue and gray. Those are the Cowboys colors, so we'll take a look at that. So now we can see that Cole Beasley is assigned as blue and Ezekiel Elliott is assigned as gray. Because we have receiver name on the x-axis, we don't actually need this legend either. So we could actually drop that with theme legend position equal to none. And we'll drop that. So now we just have the clean graph, minimal clean graph with the Cole Beasley and Ezekiel Elliott and then range of data across. So that's interesting. It's a quick exploratory graph. But if I wanted to look at kind of the summary data within here as well, instead of doing these jitters, or I guess it's sticking with the jitter, I could do a stat summary. So we'll add a stat equal to median, color equal to red, and geom equals point, size equal. So the, well, here we go. If I'm making a mistake here, like calling stat, so we can actually look at, comment out that line real quick, and let's say I wanted to know what stat summary actually. So if I call question mark on a function, so stat summary, I'll actually pull up metadata around what the actual function does. So stat summary has these calls and it shows all the different arguments for it, the data that's coming into it, the position, breaks, all these different functions you have, as well as some examples of what I wanted. So if I actually wanted to call this correctly, I could say function.y, call me. Now when I plot it, it creates the actual dot. And this dot now is the median plotted within. So we can see that, again, Cole Beasley's median is a little bit higher than Ezekiel Elliott's, mainly because he has a greater distribution of data points around. DIY box plot. So if I didn't want to do a box plot DIY, I could just drop all of this. So we'll just delete this real quick. And we'll do geom box plot. So call this, and we'll do the scale color manual. And now we have a box plot. So a box plot basically shows you the range, so the 25th percentile, 75th percentile, the median, and the middle, as well as the data points that are outside the typical range. I could build over this. So again, because we're building up a layer of graphics, anything I plot will be overlaid on top of this. So I could put my geom jitter back in. And we'll do a low alpha again, so 0.2. And now if I do this, it'll actually build up the points over top. So we can see the box plot for summary data and then the actual geom points plotted on top of it. He wants to see a swarm plot. So let's do GG swarm. I think it's B swarm. Yep, B swarm. And we can see what the actual, I think it's called swarm. B swarm. No, I went GG swarm. GGB swarm. I'll get to there eventually. So we'll load a new library that gives me the ability to actually load or to call swarm plots. So let's say we don't want this anymore. And we want GGB swarm and GMB swarm. I was just checking myself to make sure I call the actual right. So let's see if this just works. So rather than doing jitter where it's assigning, you know, truly random swarm plots or kind of random jitter, it's kind of building up these where it's packing them together. As you can see, the data points are actually slightly aligned and touching and aggregated here together, as opposed to a geom jitter where you're actually doing truly random x coordinates. So do geom jitter alpha equals to 0.1. So we'll make those really light so we can kind of see a little bit. So the light points are way out here. We can see the B swarm is looking. And again, because it's a layers and layers and layers and layers, I could still do a stat summary on top of it and call the function dot y, which I'm remembering now, color equal to red. And geom equal to point. So if we do this, now we have three different layers that all are built up on top of it. So we have the B swarm on the back, the slightly overlaid, kind of redundant, but there jitter points, and then the red dots, which is gonna be the median. I think we've probably done this part to death, so let's move on a little bit and do some team level analysis. The other part is that now that I'm, 20 minutes into this, 30 minutes into this, I'd probably like to talk about is this is an R script. So this is literally just a text file, essentially, that I'm typing in. That's fine, but that means that everything shows up here, and if I wanted to write anything about what I'm doing, like comparison of Zeke and Cole, that I have to do it in these comments, where basically I do a pound sign before, and this is now non-evaluated code. These is a comment about the above. That's fine. If I want to do something more like what Nick did the other day, I could use an R markdown note. And if we did one of these and just did the default, this is going to be much more akin to what we're seeing with a traditional notebook style. So we can actually write text. So we'll just actually delete all of this. We'll load the same library. So library Tidyverse. And call that. We can do our loading at the very top. This is going to be NFL scraper, and we can do a code chunk. Basically, everything outside of these code chunks, which are shown with the triple dots or triple backticks and an R, this indicates this is an R code chunk. I could also make this into, say, a Python code chunk or a SQL code chunk, but we'll stick to R. Basically, everything outside of this is text. So I can say this is text about what I am doing today. So all of this is gonna be not evaluated as code, so I can actually make notes about what I'm doing or what I'm misspelling, and then everything in here will actually be the data set I'm looking at. So now I'm actually looking at evaluated code. So I can play by play, and I have it set to spit the code out here into the console, but you could also have it where it shows up in line as Nick did the other day. So let's do markdown and show output in line. That. We do play by play. It's now going to show it in line, so I could actually hide all of this and have a wider screen if I want. So we'll do a mix of this, and then if I wanted to close that, I just close the chunk, but things are still present in. Let's say we wanted to do going back to Team EPA. So let's say play by play data, and we're going to filter. We'll steal some of this. It's going to be late. We'll filter some of the so we don't want possession, we don't want data where the possession team is missing. We want the 2018 for year, and we're going to group by possession team and then do summary around that. So we'll do summarize. Again, we'll do mean equal to mean of EPA and a.remove equal true. And we'll do a count. No, we don't need a count there. Let's do that. So if I do this, you can see that it does it by alphabetical possession team. So that's fine, but that's not that great reading it, because I don't know what's the largest, what's the smallest, or what else I'm looking for. So maybe I could look for max equals to max of EPA in a remove equal true. Min equals min of EPA in a dot remove equal true. I can do this and it shows me the max and min and then the actual average. But again, because it's sorting alphabetically, that's not that useful. So I can do another new function, which is going to be arrange. If I arrange by mean, it's actually going to sort the data according to the mean here. To start with the smallest, what's it called? The smallest observation first. So if I want to do largest, I can actually call descending on this. So it'll be arrange descending mean. So now I'll take the largest observation. And we see that in 2018, Kansas City, New Orleans, and Los Angeles Rams actually had the highest average EPA, and were leaps and bounds above even the fourth place team, almost double that in here for New Orleans versus the fourth place team. So you can see that these teams are actually sorted appropriately. So able to actually take a look at my data set as opposed to just doing it randomly. As far as Isabella had a question about tables, there's a lot of good table packages out there. I would say Cable Extra is a great one for starting out. It's very rich ecosystem. It's been around for a long time. It's really stable and has lots of nice features, and it builds off of the cable package, which is simple tables in R, or I guess knitter package would actually be what I'm talking about, which is knitter cable, which is a way of creating tables in R. There's also GT, which I'm a big fan of. Which is one that Rich Iannone has been developing. It's a little bit newer, so it's still under kind of some breaking changes as he gets through it, but both are good options. So let's say we did want to create a table, and we had, we'll sign this back to be top EPA teams. So we actually save this as an object. We can see it over here. If we did top EPA teams cable, to actually create a little table here of everything. So this, rather than actual printing in the print method through base R, is actually creating a markdown table. So we can do over here. You can see that it's actually creating a bunch of raw HTML, actually not markdown, HTML. So I could paste this into something like GitHub and it looked pretty, but it doesn't look so great in the R. As opposed to doing something like GT, when we do this, it creates a formatted table out of the box with alternating white and gray lines. This is one that Ben Baldwin's been using a lot, and he has been making good use of it. You can do things like group directly, and it's going to give you a rich ability to kind of quickly iterate across nice graph. I'm gonna find out. I don't think it's picking up. Yeah, it's not gonna pick up external paint. I'll have to work on that. But that's those are some good options for creating some really cool tables. So done some exploratory data analysis there. The one thing I have not mentioned yet has actually been mutate, which is kind of surprising at this point. So let's say I wanted to create a new column or new feature or create a new interaction of everything together. So take my EPA teams. So let's say we take EPA teams and we want to actually look at the average EPA per game. I don't think this is really the right way to do it, but just as a quick example of using mutate. So we know that this thing we've created has mean, max, min. If I wanted to look at mean and actually divide it by number of games, again, this is not appropriate at all, but let's say mean divided by 16. What mutate is saying here is create a new column. We're going to call this game EPA. And so we're going to assign the new column a name of game EPA, and it's going to be the mean divided by 16. Please don't judge me for doing that. Could have done it a different way. But we can see that there's now a game EPA column, which is the average EPA divided by 16 for the because every team gets a bye. So that's what mutate could do. Mutate could also take additional functions. So if you wanted to mutate game EPA equals square root of something or whatever, this is going to apply it to every row. So you did that as opposed to summarize. Summarize is collapsing a data set. Mutate is creating new columns within the data set. So those are not actually good observations. Hi, buddy. How are you doing? Let's get you back up here. You want to see the world, I know. So let's say we wanted to do something else. So let's create a new cell. We will take top EPA teams, and we're going to mutate. Because it's ranked, because all of them are here, they're in order. So we can do something like mutate rank equals row number. So now I have a column here, and I can actually select rank everything. What this is doing is basically taking the rank column and putting it at the very front, because I can see that first. So we can see where the ranking is, and rather than having to count rows, we now have a rank column. So that actually be a better use of something like mutate, where you're creating a new column based off of some observation. If I wanted to look at, say, like the top or bottom teams, I could again do something like filter and look at team, or let's see, rank greater than 5 or 6, or rank less than 28. If I do this, it gets me all the teams ungroup. Let's try just the top 6. Rank greater than 6. What am I doing wrong? Less than 6 would be the right answer there, because I'm actually looking, I was thinking of it being a factor. And so greater than 6 is good, but in this case, it's actually as an int. So it's actually saying less than 6 is good. That's a little brain fart. And we'll say greater than 28. So let's see if that works. That worked as intended. So let's say this is now the top 5 observations and the bottom 5 observations. So the very best team, EPA versus Arizona, was literally basically every play was equivalent to the negative of what Los Angeles was putting out there. So some interesting stuff. People want to see more dogs. Don't forget to follow y'all at the top of the page. Let's see some other ideas I had. I had a good one with third downs. So let's go all the way back up to our observations. So we're going to go back to the full play-by-play data. So we're going to take the full play-by-play data, and we're going to filter play type equal to pass. I think this has a play type. let's say receiver player name is dot na receiver player. Okay, so this is basically taking observations and let's say select possession team and down yards to go, yards gained, air yards. Let's look. Okay, so this is something I wanted to look at because I wanted to make a comparison between Pittsburgh and their use of third downs as opposed to the rest of the league. In 2018, I really felt like we noticed that Pittsburgh, which is a team actually I like, Ben Roethlisberger, who's their quarterback in 2018, really likes to throw deep on third down, especially third and short, where a lot of people would say, oh, you know, take the easy yards. He's taking the deep shot there a lot. So if we wanted to look at what the whole NFL was doing, we're basically looking at a down. So let's say we want filtered down equal to 3. Now we're only going to get third down plays. And let's take a look at what this looks like with ggplot. So AES, we're going to say X is equal to air yards, basically how far the ball was thrown. So that's where the ball's traveled to where it would hit the receiver and before they catch it. So how far the ball was thrown. We're only going to assign an X variable because we're not going to calculate a Y. It's going to be calculated automatically for this, which is geom density. If we do this, we can take a look at what the average air yards are for the entire NFL. We can see some plays where the air yards is actually not there. So let's do one more filter up here. Filter is.na air yards and call it again. We build it this time and now we see there's no missing data. So we can see that the vast majority of passes are actually thrown around 3. So if we actually did geom D line and we'll do X intercept. We're just going to eyeball that and see if that's, oh, we're about 5 yards. We'll do color equal to, someone's going to be yelling at me that I could actually calculate this. I eyeballed it and it worked out just fine. So we can see that the vast majority of passes are thrown at about 5 yards. That's the big point. However, obviously, there's some passes that are thrown behind the line of scrimmage, some passes that are thrown deeper down the line. So if I were going to create some third down plays, we're going to do a little bit richer. Let's say third down. It's going to be all these plays. We don't want the plotting anymore, but now we just have third down plays. Third down. Cool. And if we wanted to check to make sure that we did get only third down plays with our filter, we actually call distinct, which tells me what's the distinct observation within the down column. So take our data set and then call distinct on. We only have third down. So third down, and we're going to create a new data frame. So let's say, let's break it up by number of yards to go. So mutate, so let's do a mutate yards on third equals to, and we're going to use a new function here called case when. This is basically a switch, which basically if you think of something like an if else Howard equals to Howard one cat, and we'll say if Howard is equal to Howard, he's a dog. If not, he's a cat. Howard's a dog, so that's great. But if Howard were Howard cat, now he is not showing up as a dog, so it's going to the fail command and saying cat. So Howard is now a cat because it failed. But if I wanted to build up a lot of different observations of if-elses, I would have to write all of these. And what case when does is instead of if-else, so case when Howard equals to dog, we'll say dog. And if Howard equals to cat, then assign cat. true equals NA. So this is basically saying if Howard is equal to Howard, then he's a dog. Howard is equal to cat, then he's a cat. And if that all else fails and it's just true, then we're just going to assign an NA to it. If we do this, we can see that Howard is in fact a dog. So really we should be using some type of input here. So rather than actually specifying the input, which is not appropriate, we're going to use just the basic idea. I don't even know if that was helpful, but I wanted to talk about it. Case when. So going back to third down plays. So I want to look at different bins because I know that lots of people in the NFL community love binning data. That's the best thing to do. It really is not that great, but we're going to do it anyway because we're interested. So let's say that yards to go. We'll do one thing first. Filter yards to go less than 11, or less than or equal to 10. So this is basically saying a reasonable play, a third and 10 or shorter. So we don't want any of these third and 20. We don't even want third and 35 or anything crazy. We're just going to find reasonable third down, third and 10. We're going to say when a yards to go is, let's say, less than or equal to 3, and we're going to assign 3 yards to go, 3 or less. And then if yards to go is between, or don't need that. So this tilde is the assignment here. So this is the logical. So saying if yards to go is less than or equal to 3, then assign things to the right. If yards to go, if between yards to go, and we'll say, 4 and 6, so the left and right side, then 4 to 6. Between yards to go, and what this is saying is, again, bookending it. So if the yards to go is between these two observations, we'll say 7 and 10. We'll say 7 to 10 yards to go. And if it fails, we'll say true equal to NA. What am I missing? Oh, I'm missing a bracket here. There we go. Cool. I was missing the last parentheses to close out my mute. So that doesn't really show us that much, but here, but if we go over to yards third, we can see that it went through and said yards to go 8. Now it's 7 to 10, 7, 7 to 10, 3, 3 or less, 2, 3 or less, so on and so forth. So it went through all the different observations and evaluated our switch and assigned those. And now we're going to save this. So we'll say, again, third down, bend. That's for Ben Baldwin, right? Bend for Ben Baldwin. Love Benny. So if we take this data set and third down bend, let's do one more thing here. So we're gonna say if possession team, another mutate call, is pit. So we're gonna say is pit is equal to if else, possession team equal to pit. Pit, and else it's going to be NFL. So now we have another column here that is basically saying we have something to use later for pit versus the NFL. So let's do third down bend, and we'll look at third down bend, and we'll do ggplot real quick, ASX, air yards. The question we're trying to answer here is really how far are people throwing it on third down? But we're only going to be looking at it across the specific bins that we've created for how far they're actually. If we go back to this, this is just the exact same plot we've been working on, which is air yards and how far people are throwing. If we were to say facet wrap and do by third, what do they call it up here? Yards third. Now we can see we're at 7 to 10 yards. People are typically throwing it a little bit further as opposed to, if we want to make this a little bit interesting, we really should have done fill equal to yards third. This facet is basically making small multiples, so it's splitting up the data automatically into these three different iterations of the same graphics. We can make that quickly. So if I do fill yards equal to third, it's actually overlaying them as opposed to creating new graphs. I just saw that my error face is in the chat, so that's great. I'm excited about looking at that later on. So again, because this is overlaid, we're not going to be able to see much. So let's do alpha equal to 0.2 real quick, and we can see where the different groupings are. So we can see that on third down, if it's three or less, very short pass, you know, like close to 1 or 2 yards. Let's actually make this scale x continuous. Breaks equal sequence 25. Okay, so what this is saying is rather than having breaks at only 40, 0, and 40, I'm going to create a sequence of breaks from negative 20, which should be here, to 40 here every 5. So if we take a look at this, it's a little bit more, and let's do limits equal 10, 15, 40. All right, so this is a little bit easier to read now. So we can see the third right down or less, very short passes, fourth, 4 to 6 yards, it's got this slightly longer pass, and on 7 to 10 yards, we actually see people really being excited and creating larger long distance plays. But the real question here is, what does this look like? This is the whole NFL. What does it look like for Pittsburgh specifically, as opposed to just, what's it called, to the NFL as a whole? So let's do one more. So facet wrap by is pit, number of column equal. Now it'll stack the two graphics on top of each other, and we can see what the NFL looks like versus Pittsburgh. Slightly difficult to see, but I think we can take a look at it. But the idea is that the same kind of pattern here, it's a little bit more normal distribution within Pittsburgh as opposed to the whole NFL, which I think is interesting. It's a little bit smoother. But if we look way over here at like 25 to 40 yards, we can see that these are pretty rare. Basically, there's not many observations of this in the NFL. But if you look at Pittsburgh, and if we actually did filter yards third equal to 3 or less, and did this, let's take a look at that now. So on very short passes, we can actually see there's this little bump out here. There's this little big bend bump out here where Ben's taking these deep shots on very short third downs and throwing the ball 30, 35 yards for the deep bomb when the defense is not. So we could actually, now that we've filtered to only one color, we'd actually remove the facet wrap and make it where fill is equal to is pit. And we go down here and we'll do scale color manual, values equal to yellow and black, black and yellow. There we go. And because it's actually not color, it's fill. I need to say skill. And I need to call one more thing and actually wrap it into basically making a small vector. Now we can see the NFL versus Pittsburgh. Do one more because it's a factor and I did it backwards. We want black and yellow because that also goes with the song. So the NFL is kind of gray here and we see the Big Ben bump now out here a little bit more clearly as. We also see he's throwing some that aren't quite as crazy in the middle here, where they're, you know, high efficiency plays. Basically, there's a drop off in performance after about 20 yards. So these are still high high efficiency, high likelihood of being completed. Once you get past 50 or 20 yards, it's about a 50% or less completion. So these are low percentage, but if you do hit them, it's very, very nice. Yeah, so this has been quite a bit of exploratory data analysis, and I do want to cover a brief amount of, say, like traditional machine learning or modeling. So we're going to flip over to that a little bit, but I'm going to save this so that I don't lose it for later. So scraper examples RMD. So now we have this in here. So let's do a, we're going to do a new notebook. And what we're going to do here is actually, we're going to call this modeling with the Tidyverse and Tidymodels. Cool. So Tidymodels is a newer package, but it's by written by Max Kuhn and the rest of his team, kind of building off the work of Carrot, which is another library for doing machine learning kind of in R in a very, very consistent way. So if I were to, the idea here is that we're creating a modeling workbook. So we're going to call this modeling with nflscrapR. And we're going to do something about predicting or evaluating performance of like a model with this. So I am going to preface this all by saying I am not the famous Nick Wan. I am not the famous Charlotte Gelfand. I am very much in the realm of doing, living in the data analyst role. So most of my job at our studio, which I've actually haven't talked about until now, is working with our professional customers about using our professional products and open source to do data science in the enterprise setting. So I don't actually spend that much time doing modeling or doing machine learning. I live a lot in this world with Tidy Tuesday and other things like this, which is exploratory data analysis. I really like the Tidymodels framework though, because it allows me to kind of quickly jump into something and be consistent. So I'll actually share a link real quick and get back into OBS. So let's go back to this guy and so there's an example, I'm going to be working through a similar one, which is kind of a regression example. So a linear model and then a random forest linear regression. I'll share this. Let's see if I can even share my own ones. So, well, yeah, so that article is posted there in chat. This goes through the famous, no one's ever used it before, Ames housing data set, which I'm sure everyone has probably, or a lot of people are probably sick of, not everybody, but a lot of people might be sick of. It's a good example because it's well known and there's kind of a clear goal as to what you're trying to create, which is like housing price. So this goes through a full example, a very readable format. I'm going to do something similar, but with nflscrapR data as opposed to the Ames. Let's go back into R real quick. So I've loaded Tidymodels, which is analogous to the Tidyverse, and really it it's a bunch of different packages. So things like our sample, which gives you sampling functions or fitting training versus test sets. There's Yardstick for evaluating accuracy and doing other things about the performance of it. And then Parsnip, which is the heavy lifter in terms of like fitting a model or actually doing predict. So first thing we need to do is actually take our full play-by-play data set and get it a little bit smaller. I don't want to use 277 features in my model. We'll be here all day for a random. So I'm going to do something which I probably, again, don't think is appropriate, but we're going to do it anyway, which is trying to predict EPA based off of columns or features within the play-by-play data set. So we're going to do filter play-by-play play type equals to pass. And, oh, I know why this is working. So another good example, we're going to read in a new data set. So I've been working on a local data set that's not fully read. It's not actually the same as what Nick was working on the other day. So we're going to do read a CSV from GitHub. Something really important, I'm going to jump back over to Chrome real quick to do this, is if you do try and read in data sets from GitHub, you need to make something very clear so that reader knows how to read in the data. You can see here, I have code for reading in some of these data sets. The big thing here is it says raw GitHub user content ahead of it. So if I actually go to this file on GitHub and open it up, it's going to show me the raw CSV, which it's going to try and translate for me, which is hilarious. And this is super small, so let me zoom. But this is literally the comma separated file itself. So it's got the column names and then the individual file separated by row. This is something that Reader and fread or read.csv or whatever can read into R. If I did try and read in the actual raw data set and I move to like say this travel data set here, it's not gonna be able to read this because there's literally, it's not showing it. So I have to go and click into the raw data set and now it's gonna append the raw.github user content in front of it to show the actual file. So that's something I wanted to specify for if you ever do try to read it. GitHub. So let's, I have the URL copied over here, so I'm going to steal it real quick. And we're going to move back. So this is a very long URL, and what it basically is the play-by-play data that's hosted on the Ron Yurko's nflscrapR data master GitHub branch. So again, I'm reading in the data set, so it's going to take a little while to read it in, but I eventually do get it. So I've overwritten my data set, and now I have 45,156 observations. So now the big thing I have here, though, is that I actually have play type in here. I believe. Yes. So now I actually have play type in my data, which makes it easier to filter to just passing plays as opposed. So in addition to play type, I'm gonna select a few other features or columns of interest. So things that are important for predicting expected points added. So where you are in the field, so the yard line 100, yards to go. Basically, how many yards do you need to get a first down, yards gained, how many yards you actually gained on the play of interest. Game seconds remaining, which is how much time is remaining in the game. Was a safety, did a safety occur? What is the score differential? Basically, for the home team versus the away team, what's the point differential there? What down is it? Was there a fumble? Was there a touchdown? Was there an interception? Was there a sack? I think that's, do that. So cool. So now my new model data frame has 11 variables with almost 19,000 operations. All these are passive. In addition to this, I'm actually going to create a few as factors. So we're going to mutate. Rather than doing mutate on 11 different columns potentially, I'm going to use a new one called mutate at, which allows me to specify a list. Hello, Howard. How are you, bud? Specify a list of variables that I want to work on. So we're going to do down, we're going to do fumble, interception, sack, safety, and I'm going to take all those variables and make them into a factor. So now rather than making them 0 and 1, if we were to say glimpse model df, we can see that these are now factor columns. So down, fumble, interception, sack are factors. They're still 0 or 1, but they're listed as a factor as opposed to a double or. Additionally, I'm going to do an na.omit on the data set because I want to do modeling. And again, who knows if that's appropriate, but we're going to do it. The other thing I want to do is, let's say we want to do model df. We'll do a quick count of play type and touchdown, for example. Rather than doing group by, summarize, in, whatever, I can just do count. I didn't actually play type. So let's do that one. Now I have play type and do. So we can see that a touchdown occurred on 906 plays and then 18,000 plays got a touchdown. Kind of interesting. So play type. It's always going to be can exclude that for now. So the first step that you're always going to want to do with modeling, and the same thing that Nick did, More Howard kissing. So there we go. Here's Howard. Is you want to split up into a training and a test. Basically, you don't want to do predictions on the whole data set of interest. You really want to have a separation between a large training set or a relatively large training set, and then evaluate and test the training set on the test. I think I just repeated myself like 3 times. But yeah, so that's the basic idea. Is you want to actually evaluate the model on an exterior set. So we can do this with initial split from the Tidymodels package, which is initial split, and we're gonna say model df, and we can call proponent. So a lot of people do 80-20, some people do 50-50. You could specify whatever you want. So this can be either 8-10, you can do literal math, or you could just do 0.8. So now I've created a split data frame, which is a large split, with 0.8. And before I do that, let's set seed. I'm going to do today 37. Today is going to be 30. And now I'm actually going to do that. So now I have some reproducibility around how I actually split out my data. And I'm going to do a train EPA, which is going to be training of DF split, and then test EPA, which is going to be testing data frame split. And all right, so now we have train and we have test. And just as a quick testing, let's say number of rows in train EPA divided by number of rows in test EPA. This times 100, 33%. That still doesn't make it. So let's do dim train EPA. Fun times, here we go. 14,000 and dim of 4,700. So that, oh, you wanna know why I didn't actually split it out appropriately? This is spelled wrong. This says paprop, which is not accurate. So that probably gave me a warning earlier that I didn't specify. So let's do this whole thing over. Split it out, training, testing, dim. All right, so that should be better. So let's do number of rows divided by number of rows, 4.0. Okay, cool. If I do this, I keep doing this backwards, I think. Let's do Tom spending 5 minutes doing base 25. I don't even know what I'm counting anymore. So we're just going to skip doing this. Coding live in a nutshell, whatever I just did. yeah, weird that it's called P-prop. I'm glad. So if we were going to do Nick's one, we could say poop, but we'll say prop instead of poop. So prop is which is the proportion of data. So prop equal to 0.8. And now we're going to build up a testing set. So basically like actually build up a model. So we'll assign this to a random forest model. So that's the object we're going to be saving. Poop equal to 0.8. Definitely legit. And we're going to do a random forest from the Tidymodels package. Basically this provides a unified interface to a couple different, engines for a random forest. So we'll do a regression mode in random forest. We're gonna do a number according to the predictions present. So number of predictions here, and we'll start with trees equal to 100. Oh, what are you eating there? He's eating something, we're good. It's a bone. Number of trees equal to 100 to start, and we'll do an engine. So I can set the engine equal to Ranger, which is a super fast way of doing random forest in R. I think it's either C or C++, which is nice and fast. I think it actually allows for parallelization. I'm not gonna do that today because I'm already working my MacBook Pro to death. But this could also be Spark or I believe Random Forest, which is the other. So take a random forest, set the engine equal to Ranger, and then we'll do an actual fit. If you're familiar with model fitting in R, a lot of the time it's going to be a syntax similar to like LM, EPA by a bunch of different observations. could do everything with the dot, or you could do like yards gained plus yard line, whatever. But just that this is saying this is the predicted value, and then this is the predictor. So let's do EPA, and again we're going to do it by everything, and the data set is going to be train EPA. All right, and we're going to run this random forest model. Did I not even save? I didn't save EPA up here. So we're going to add EPA to my model data frame. It's always good to have the thing you're trying to predict in your predictive data frame. Again, we're just running things. We're doing it live. This is going to take probably a couple minutes to run, or maybe a minute or two. So I'm going to let that roll for a bit. Let's do this. Here you go. Train set, test set, val set, hold set, opportunity. Yeah, so there's a pretty rich ecosystem. While this is running, let me switch over to Chrome window. So it ran, but we're gonna switch over here. So this actually goes through more options for like analyzing a model, or evaluating models and comparing different models, and how you would do like boosting or bagging or other things. I'm gonna do it very straightforward, very simple. There's a lot more here as part of Tidymodels in terms of building out like whole recipes of how to actually clean up your data, how to prepare and hack up your data and go through different things. You can see there's a lot of different packages in here you could use. I'm literally only using two of them. But that's okay because we're just doing a quick example. So let's go back into R. Yeah, so our model ran. So let's actually look at the random forest model real quick. So we can see a couple things here. It pulled up over here, but so actually fit really quickly, 22.9 seconds, 100 trees, 15,000 observations, and R squared was 0.917. So that's pretty strong already. So I'm liking this. And I think the reason why this is actually gonna be very predictive is because I'm literally using the the things you use to create EPA to predict EPA. So again, I don't think this is truly appropriate, but rather than writing out Ron's super fancy model, we're just gonna reverse hack it and pretend to predict. So if you use the same columns to predict EPA as you do to create EPA, it's pretty accurate. The other part we wanna do is actually create the predicted variables. So let's say random forest predict, and we're gonna use predict and random forest model, and the new data is going to be equal to the test EPA. So now we have a data set of the random forest predicted, which is really just going to be one column of all the predicted values based on the input. So we can actually append that to the final data set, but we're just going to leave it alone for now. So we did like random forest predict. It's going to show that it's literally just 3,700 rows of what the predicted values are for EPA. And let's go ahead and rename. This will be random forest predict equal dot pred. Let's see if that. Perfect. All right, good. Because we're going to compare this against another model. So let's do, we'll plot in a second. We're going to do some cool stuff first. Before we get to the plotting, we're actually going to do another model before we get there. So let's do a linear model. EPA linear model fit is going to be a linear regression using the Tidy Model framework. So linear regression, set engine equal to LM. So this is basically a long way of saying LM model. And then we're gonna do the same thing with the fit. So EPA by everything, data equals training EPA. This will fit super quickly because it's a linear model. It's already ran. And let's do EPA linear model fit as the coefficients, and yeah, 38 milliseconds, so that's pretty nice as opposed to the 28 seconds or whatever it took for the other framework to go. So now we also have to do a EPA or linear model predict, which will be EPA linear model fit predict, I believe. No. Yeah, I think you can do it that way. New data. I need to tell what the data is. So we could pipe that, but let's just do it as predict linear model EPA linear model fit new data equals to the test EPA. So we need to give it the new data to predict upon. Again, linear model predict, it's going to give us 3,700 rows of. So let's actually rename again. So this would be linear model predict equal to pred. And we'll look at that. Awesome. Cool. So we're in good shape there. So we can actually create the test data, test EPA. Look at this. It has all the columns, and we can actually final model data frame. And this is going to be test EPA bind columns. And we're going to use what LM pred, and reinforced pred, I believe. Cool. So let's take a look at that final model data frame. So let's just actually glimpse this because it'll be easier to read. All right, so now we have EPA, and we also have the predictors down here so we can compare how our two models did. And let's actually select EPA, LM pred, RF pred, everything. So let's put them at the very front so we can actually see them really quickly. Yep, EPA. We can already see that pretty close prediction for the RF pred and the EPA, but this is not the best way to evaluate a model, which is literally scrolling through the data set and looking at it. So let's take a look at the rest of it. Animate it. Man, I do not have enough time to animate it. I did some GG Animate stuff with some nflscrapR data last week and had really cool plot and did like 1,000 frames, and it took like 10 minutes to render. I was like, oh, I did not realize it was going to take this long, but it looked really cool at the end of the day. And because I'm talking about it and I want to take a look at it now, GG Animate went. So Ben Baldwin's been putting together those QBR ratings over time. These are really pretty. One of my colleagues, Jonathan Regenstein, was like, hey, make an animated GIF out of it. So I did. So I went through and did some scraping to get the data. I need to update this because they literally changed the website after I did it. But it goes through each week and looks at QBR rating over time. I know, buddy. Come here. Ugh. He likes GIFs too. So it goes through and does the difference. And then I also did it for some of the top teams and looking how the people changed. So that'll be your GIF, but we're going to stick to basic. All right, so let's do one more thing before we plot. So let's do final model data frame, and let's do metrics truth equal EPA and estimate equals to random forest pred. So this is basically one function that tells me, okay, compare the actual outcome to the predicted outcome. It gives me RMSE, R squared, MAE, basically a few different ways to evaluate the model. So it's a pretty decent model. I mean, it's pretty predictive of what the actual value is because it's really how you do it anyway. And so you could evaluate this, or you could do the LM predicted. Little bit less of a great model. The RMSE is much higher and the R squared is a little bit lower. So that's one way of doing it. Alternatively, we could plot it, which I think is what everyone's been waiting for. So we'll get to that. Oh my gosh, I can get into the terminal. Let's not do that. All right, so we'll create a new cell and we'll do ggplot. Let's do ggplot final model data frame. Is 8x equal to random forest pred? Yeah, let's do the predicted on the x, actual on the y. Y equals EPA. And then we can do GM point, and we're just going to go ahead and do a GM smooth and fit a quick linear model just to show what it would look like. Color equal to red. So let's plot it real quick. What have I done? Final model D. Yay. Mapping must be. Let's not do that first. All right, so that's pretty strong. So let's see what was wrong with my geom smooth. Method equals to lm and color equals to red. I think that's it. All right, sweet. So yeah, not only are the metrics good, but yes, if you basically calculate EPA by hand and compare it to what actual EPA is, it's pretty accurate. It's really good at finding things that are positive, less so in some of these negative plays, potentially because those are going to be the noisiest parts. Sack, fumbles, fumble recoveries for touchdowns, all sorts of other things like that are probably a bit noisier than just traditional good offensive plays that gain yards or score. So that would be kind of my interpretation of basic model. And if we did, instead of the random forest predict, let's look at the linear model predict. I think it's going to be worse. Yeah. So we can really see that they really are quite different in terms of the random forest model was much tighter to the actual trend line as opposed to linear model. And we saw it as well when we were looking at the performance. So if we did both of the as well. So we can again look at the 0.73 on the R squared versus the. Yeah. Cool. I think that's about it in terms of how much Howard can handle. He'll probably need to go here potty in a break. So I'm gonna take a page out of Nick's book and do some AMA or other questions. Let me save this as model notebook. RND. That's saved. I'm also going to flip back over to Chrome to show some of those other examples. Again, this is pretty quickly like diving through a bunch of examples. I wrote a whole cookbook of literally creating basic graphics and then building upon them to create better graphics using nflscrapR public data. So all sorts of fun stuff that you could find here. And all this is actually coded via R Markdown and published into an HTML web page. Shiny app stream sometime. I would be totally on board with that. I don't actually do much Shiny dev, so that would be very much a rock'em sock'em Tom on the recovering and lots of question and answering. So that'd be more fun because I'd actually be able to show a more traditional workflow, which is, Stack Overflow search Shiny, something like that. As opposed to just coding in the RStudio interface and never coming up for air. I still had a couple of trip up moments, and this was very much kind of practice ahead of time. So don't, I guess, if you're trying to evaluate live coding, far from very good. I would evaluate someone like maybe Hadley has a couple videos of like the whole game. Hadley, the whole game. I don't know why I'm Googling things. But Hadley Wickham has a whole game video, and then Dave Robinson has a couple good streaming. The other part is there's pretty rich information out there for cookbook and like creating graphics for nflscrapR. If you did want to learn more about using machine learning inside R, this is a free book by Bradley Bunk, and if I can say that correctly, I apologize, and Brandon Greenwell. So this is a really cool book I've been reading through that walks through very digestible examples of different machine learning models and kind of the concerns and how to use them and evaluate their performance. So kind of the basics of getting. The other thing is, again, if you're interested in just kind of generic getting started with exploratory data analysis or learning how to use a programming language like R or Python, please try out the Tidy Tuesday project. Every Tuesday, there's a new data set, and there's dozens, if not hundreds, of people analyzing that data. So it's a really cool community built around data visualization and data cleaning and using data science programming language. And The other part is, I know I focused here on R, and obviously Nick did a ton of stuff in Python. I really want to emphasize that kind of whatever path you choose is great. Both are going to get you job prospects. Both are very functional and get you a lot of bang for your buck. I'd really like to see maybe some more contributions from Python into the Tidy Tuesday hashtag. So right now, if we went to Twitter and looked at Tidy Tuesday, I think it's almost exclusively, well, we don't even have to look at Twitter. We can do our studio. Let's do this. All right, we're gonna go off script here real quick. So let's do, Howard, you gotta go down, bud. Let's go down here. Let's do library rtweet. Rtweet is one of my favorite packages. It's amazing. You can actually download Twitter data directly inside our studio. So let's do search tweets, Tidy Tuesday, n equals 18,000. So if I do this, it's going to go through query against the Twitter API and actually collect all of the tweets in the past week that had the Tidy Tuesday hash. And I made the biggest mistake of not assigning this to anything, but because here's a new hashtag tip. Last value, let's say that this is tweet data frame. Last value basically takes whatever the last thing you did and saves it for you. So that saved my butt. I didn't have to re-query. Amazing. Thank you, dot last value in R. So now I can take the tweet data frame, select text and username. Your ID, what is it? Status ID. Text screen name. Screen name. That's what I'm looking for. Screen name. Boom. So we only have those tweet df do filter string detect text, and we're gonna say to lower text. Basically, this whole thing I'm doing is I'm trying to find R stats. So 465 observations of R stats. What I'd really like to do is, if I search for Python, is I want to find more Python in there too, or more other things. So if we did, that'd be really cool. I want to see more than 8. Hashtag PyData or PyDTuesday almost got off the ground, but then it kind of died. So maybe that could be a good hashtag, which would be really cool. So let's go back and yeah. So yeah, anyway. Tidy Tuesday is just a great, in my opinion, way to get started with learning R and other data science languages, because you're able to work asynchronously. So you can actually work in real time with the community and see what people are creating, or you can just look at the end of the week and kind of copy and build off what other people are creating. Yeah, these were identical tweets. They're actually retweets. So I should include retweets equal false. Do that. Retweets. I don't think we need to do. All right, so tweet data. Man, I did the same thing last value. Luckily, I got the code here. So let's see if rstat or Python. Yeah, there was one observation of Python. So let's make that more than one. And let's see rstat. All right, we got 53 observation parts. So lots of cool data visualization there. It'd be cool to see some Altair in there as well. But all that to be said, that I like Tidy too. Very passionate about helping people get started with digestible data sets that are well, you know, defined. There's a data dictionary. You can look at all the data sets and see what other people are doing. French train delays, PhDs awarded, board games, whatever you want. Tennis Grand Slam champions, if you want to stick with sports data, there's all sorts of data. Yeah, I think I'm about tapped out. That's 8:50. I'll take some questions. I think Charla and Nick, I really appreciate y'all sticking around. I think I saw Jack Daniel. Thank you also for hanging out for a while. I know the call. There were some more people earlier in the stream. Isabella, I appreciate some of the cool questions you had. Thanks for hanging out. So Data Jake, awesome. Let me, I'm going to do this real quick. I'm going to do some live followings. Oh dear. Add Data Jake. that your Twitter handle? Hey, Jake Daniels, how's it going? I already follow you. Hello, friend. This is the Ontario squad. The Ontario squad in the chat right now. I really just need Rich Iannone to round out the chat room. Well, if we're here already, let's do Tidy Tuesday. Just to show you some of the examples here. So a bunch of different graphics. You can see that they're very dispersed in terms of what they actually are. GG Animate, that's an Apple ad. All sorts of. Am I going to stream more often, or is this a one-off thing? It's definitely not a one-off thing. I'm trying to decide how I want to do this in terms of if it's like a stream every Monday and go through the data cleaning I do to prepare data for Tidy Tuesday. There's a lot of behind-the-scene coding I do to take data from very random places and clean it up. So let's think of like dairy production. I think I have something there. Yeah, I'm interested to see if it would be better to do a lunchtime stream or an afternoon evening stream. I would love a data cleaning stream. Awesome. Yeah, we could do Marie Kondo Tidy Tuesday. Just all the stuff I do to get these random data sets. If we look at these raw data sets here, they are nasty. These are Excel files, and you already know that they're not good. No offense. Makes me sad. So there's a lot of... Yeah. The raw data sets can be found here. There's even more data that's source of interest interested in, much of which requires a lot of fun Excel sheet data cleaning. Enjoy. Data cleaning is my passion. Yeah, Charlotte, I think you and I can agree that we really enjoy it. I consider myself like a data janitor. I very much enjoy. Cool. I want to also give a huge shout out to Nick for actually moderating. I literally installed all this stuff 24 hours ago, and Nick got me on board and upped very quickly and stuck around for the whole 2 hours doing hype man stuff and clipping things such as Howard, which I saw, and coding fail face, which is fantastic. We'll see how that goes on the follow-up. I'll upload everything to YouTube. But yeah, I think I'm done coding for today. For the four of us left in the room, definitely sounds like data cleaning would be an interesting stream. So maybe I'll try and do that. Cool. Howard is like half asleep and needs to go to the bathroom. Let's all say goodbye to Howard and another hello and goodbye to Nick. And thank you for hanging out, Sharla, Nick, Jack, and Isabella. See you around. Now's the awkward part where I get to click this.